with Raheem.
Jana.
Yes. Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five group. Legendary, and we're in the legendary place, New York City, Manhattan. So as you can see, we can say good evening, America.
Yes. Right.
Today. So how are you doing today?
I'm great.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm also great. Yes. So we are in Times Square, and I came here from London. This is the London New York connection.
That's right.
Yes, you've been doing music for a very long time, which gives you so much, you know, leverage and experience and everything. It's been a part of your life.
That just means I'm really old, Jana.
I wouldn't say that, because actually there is a word for that. You know, which means that I've been doing music for a long time, meaning all my life.
Okay.
So that's a good thing.
Gotcha. I understand.
Yeah. So what inspired you?
I had a few inspirations. My mom was my greatest inspiration. Thank you, Mom. She sung around the house in every aspect, every nuance of what she did domestically. And she had an angelic voice. She didn't sing professionally. She wasn't professionally trained, but she had chops. So I was exposed to all of the phenomenal artists that she listened to: Aretha Franklin, Gladys Knight and the Pips, Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, the Jackson 5, Elton John. There were so many that I was exposed to. It was an awesome learning experience.
Wow, that is amazing. It's always great to be inspired by the music that you grew up with. It always becomes a part of your experience.
Absolutely.
Do you feel like music became a part of your life experience as well?
Yes.
It's a journey.
It is a journey. Yes. You know, every aspect of my life, I could probably pick out a song to appropriately accompany that journey.
That's awesome. Is that like how your lyrics is inspired as well, like real life events a lot, or a lot of the times stories that you hear?
I try not to so much live vicariously through the stories that I hear that other people have told. I try to draw on my own experiences. I have enough of them to utilize them in stories, and that's pretty much what I thought.
Yeah, that is a great thing actually to do, because when you fully connect your music with your own personal journey, that makes a real artist.
I would say so, yeah.
So that's when life imitates art and art imitates life.
Exactly.
So you're one of those artists, isn't it?
I pride myself on that.
Well, what artists have you been inspired by as well, as in terms of hip-hop?
In terms of hip-hop, well, I don't know if the viewing audience is aware, but prior to my group, there were really no hip-hop artists. So I wasn't inspired by other hip-hop artists to be a hip-hop artist. We inspired other hip-hop artists to be hip-hop artists. But prior to us, the inspirations that we got musically were from the greats of soul and R&B, James Brown, you know, Stevie Wonder. There were DJs that played, you know, in the parks outside for free, and there were upstart people who did very, very simple examples of what we now hear and what we now know as rapping, but it wasn't as intricate or as sustained as, you know, someone rapping on a song. It was more like, you know, a bar or two at best.
Wow, but you've inspired a lot of people and generations to come.
Yes.
Because as we know now, hip-hop is a worldwide phenomenon, and it has been for a very long time. I can tell this because, you know, I was born and raised in the Soviet Union, and I grew up in Russia, and I could literally see how hip-hop took over time. You know, I grew up listening to a lot of hip-hop artists from the States, and that really influenced my childhood. So you can tell that hip-hop, you witnessed the times when it was starting, and you pioneered and paved the way a lot of things, but at the same time, now it's literally influencing the whole world.
Yes, you know, to me, it was that was inevitable that it influenced the world, because unlike singing is much more technically difficult. You know, you have to hit certain notes, and if you're not in key, then you're out of key, and that doesn't sound very, very good. Whereas, you know, rapping, you know, you're speaking, rhythmically speaking. And so rap music has provided a platform for people all over the world that didn't really know that they had this platform, because prior to rap music, everybody who wanted this kind of platform had to be a singer. So now that you don't have to be a singer and you can be a rhythmic speaker, that's a lot easier, and you get to tell your story over the drums, like how they did in Africa. That's where it originated.
Yeah, so as long as you literally have the keys to the lyrics,
yes, exactly.
You can be on key,
exactly.
In hip-hop.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yep.
And
yep.
And then it influenced everything else around us, art.
Yes, it really did. Art, fashion, you know. I had the opportunity to travel, luckily.
I just have
Based on, you know, releasing our music and hip-hop and stuff. And going to countries that English was not their primary language, people knew every word to our songs. And that just goes to show you that music is universal. If you are singing about something, or you're rapping about something in your music that resonates with people and it touches them, it doesn't matter what language it's in, people are going to embrace it.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Music is the universal language.
Absolutely.
That's what I'm always saying. And that's why artists, they have to realize that they are influencing the people and the audience.
Yes.
It's not about just trying to make the money and cut the check. It's
right.
Also about realizing that because it's that language that helps connect people and make the world truly multicultural and multi-diverse and connected, because of that, what you're saying and the words are truly powerful.
Absolutely. Words are power. There are seven sciences that you can master, that if you master one of these sciences, you're just a very powerful person. And the science of rhetoric is one of those sciences. That's the mastery of words. You master words, you can move mountains.
Yes. In fact, you can even avoid physical wars.
Absolutely.
By the power of the words.
Of words, that's right.
And words have been perpetuated because certain words were not created and emphasized correctly.
Absolutely.
And somebody got offended by something. So that's why also I feel like in this society right now, they're trying to control words a bit too much.
Yes, they are.
Because words is something that allows people to speak their mind and really express themselves and be the speaker and be the voice of change and the voice of the people.
Very true, very true.
So, you know, the whole AI thing, you know,
yes.
Artificial intelligence, it's connected to the Bitcoin. And in fact, it's a system that is going to control how you're going to word things,
oh, wow.
You know, online.
Online, wow.
so powerful. They open people's minds.
Look. You made me take my shades off. Look. You know, people have, there's a big misconception about magic, right? Casting a spell is nothing more than spelling a word,
yes.
Right? And all you need in order for a spell to be effective are people to participate knowingly or unknowingly. A perfect example of a magic spell, okay? A nickname is a very simple example of a spell, and a nickname is usually a name bestowed on a person to describe some outstanding characteristic or behavior. I had three friends growing up, three friends named Melvin. We named one Fat Melvin, we named one Skinny Melvin, and we named one Bumpy Face Melvin. None of the three Melvins wanted the pseudonyms that preceded their names, but because they did not vehemently reject those names upon the onset of receiving them, at some point in time, Fat Melvin, Skinny Melvin, and Bumpy Face Melvin was walking down the street by themselves, and somebody called to them in the distance, "Yo, Fat Mel, Skinny Mel, Bumpy Face Mel." And when either of them turned around to acknowledge their names being called, that's when the magic spell was successful.
It's true, because the original magicians, going back thousands and thousands of years ago, were the people who could have the power of words and
absolutely.
Who could manipulate words in the correct way, at the right time, in the right place, and they were the original artists. The magicians of those times, the priests, were the magicians. And they were the people who could open people's minds. They were literally ruling the society so that kings and queens who were ruining the countries and places so that they won't misuse their power and their money and it just, the power wouldn't just get into their heads so that they won't think, oh, I have this amount of people in front of me, so I'm just gonna do whatever.
Exactly.
So the priests were the original magicians in those times, and they were the people who could change the world around them through casting spells and through the power of the words.
Yep.
And now what people don't realize, you see, we are—
what people don't realize,
we have very powerful words to say right here in Times Square, because it's that time. Is that right now, the artists, the musicians, have the power over words. But then it makes a difference if the artist is writing their own lyrics, because it comes from their soul and it comes from their own energy.
Absolutely.
So the more powerful energy the person possesses, the more powerful the influence is going to be.
Absolutely.
They could say something even in their own backyard and it's going to affect the whole world.
Absolutely.
And this is why the music industry is using this type of knowledge so much, because they know that people are singing along to songs, the lyrics and whatever is sang in those songs is going to affect people on a subconscious level.
Yes. The power of suggestion is profoundly powerful. That's why the people who are responsible for programming the music that we hear every day on our local radios are called program directors. They program the music, they program the listener.
Yeah.
So if every day of your young, impressionable life, your favorite artist who's in your ear more hours a day than probably your parent and your teacher, they're telling you that the way that they became successful was to stand on the corner and sling packs of dope, crack, whatever, and shoot people. The most influenced percentage of the population will become that. That's the reason why our government placed strict regulations on tobacco manufacturers, prohibiting them from advertising the sale of tobacco in any advertising medium, because they know full well that a percentage of the population already smokes cigarettes, but if they were to advertise it, a much larger percentage of the population would smoke.
Yes, definitely. And would you say that artists of today, they have to realize more of that responsibility, because they are literally casting spells on people, isn't it? So
yes, it's sorcery.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And I would have to add that the true knowledge is actually hidden far, far in the woods. It's not being sold or promoted in any big city.
No.
If you see anything to do with that, that is probably fake news.
Right. Exactly.
And the true knowledge is something that will need to be awakened in people today at this time, because we're on the crossroads of history.
Yes, we are.
So we are on the crossroads of history. How do you feel about that?
I think that it's a very important and crucial time. I think, there's a lot that we need to be paying attention to that we aren't, because of the extraneous distractions going on all around us. And some of it is conscious and deliberate on the part of the people who don't want us to pay attention. And some of it isn't, but the majority of it is staged. And I would suggest when you're in public, especially places like this where there's this large gathering of people, I would suggest that you remove your earbuds from your ear and really pay attention to what's going on around you, because there's just no telling what could go down. And if you're not aware of your surroundings or what's going on, you're listening to loud music, there's an explosion, a gunshot, you won't hear it. All you catch is the residual effect of that. You'll see the people running, or you might get trampled by people running, So I would suggest that you really pay close attention to what's happening around you.
Yes, and I also would like to add that I think that people today are forgetting that it's not a one-way kind of dealing with life, because it's a two-way thing. A person, somebody is existing in this world, but then the world also responds to this person.
Yes.
So if they just walk around and not care about what's happening around them, plugged in, they don't realize that the world is sending them signs that could uplift them, that could change their life. It's sending them signs to show how they could live a more meaningful life.
Absolutely.
Rather than just being like a robot, literally, following ideas and stereotypes that have been promoted by somebody else, in them. I have a song about that. It's called ID. But it's about, what does it mean to have an identity?
Mm-hmm.
And it's an ID because people associate that with the name on the passport,
right.
Some kind of ID, how old you are, your age, just this statistics, basically.
Right.
But are you the statistics, or are you an individual,
right,
who's living a meaningful life in a moment? We're in Times Square, so it means times. There's time. There's time for everything.
Mm.
There every moment is meaningful. The past, the present, and the future.
Absolutely.
So when people are zoned out this way, they stop realizing that the world is sending them some kind of connection, but they're not connected to anything.
Right, that's very true. One of the main things about what's going on right now, people want to control your perception. They want to control what you think. Because if they can control what you think, they can probably control what you say. And based on that fact, religion has been put in place to cause a perception. And, you know, we've had religious wars in this world since the beginning of religion. And based on, you know, this group of people have a different belief than this group of people. Now, for the sake of argument, let's say, you know, let's say that nobody's right. Everybody is wrong in their assumption. Because, I mean, in my humble opinion, I would say that everybody's wrong, because there has to be only one creator. It doesn't matter what religion you subscribe to, what you call the creator. It's the creator of man, period. There's only one of those, all right?
And there's humans that are created in the image and likeness of God.
That's right, exactly.
Of the creator.
Absolutely. And so, with that being said, you know, looking at someone and judging them based on what name they call the creator, how they pray to the creator, what their religious doctrines believe, and if it's contrary to yours, keep in mind that man made these religions up. These religions were created by man and have absolutely nothing to do with your spirituality and your connection to the creator. Nothing.
Yes. And the true knowledge precedes all of those religions.
Absolutely.
The real knowledge that they wanted us to get, and in fact it's the crucial time for us to remember, to really go back in time, in Times Square, and change the time. We are on the crossroads of history, crossroads of time,
yep,
in Times Square, and this is the time to make a change, to realize that the power belongs to the people and to each and every one of you. And I think it's the time also to stop all of those misconceptions, and it's the time for one knowledge for the rest of the world, true knowledge, for that to come.
Absolutely.
That will unite people and make the world a truly multicultural, diverse, in an individual and real way, not in a fake way, but it will make the world come together as people. But if everybody could come to an agreement and understand what's real and what's fake, you know, that has to do with this ancient knowledge, and it's the time for that to be reset. The time is about to be reset, genuinely, because we only have a few years, literally, for our for humanity to make that choice.
Yes.
To make the choice which way to go.
Right.
Because the way that is going at the moment has been going for the past couple of thousand years, and especially throughout 20th century, mm-hmm, with World War I, World War II, we are on the verge of something that could potentially go even worse. But if people make a conscious choice to free themselves,
right,
to emancipate themselves, mm-hmm, from the matrix,
right,
to free their minds in the real way, then the humanity could take a completely different route, and that could be the path to the golden age.
Absolutely.
I believe that, because just in that transition period when you could have been, you almost fell off a cliff, you know what I'm saying? But then you found out that life is much more powerful and there's nothing better than life. You know, it's that kind of rebirth. So humanity can really come out of the dark ages that it has been going through for the past few thousand years, and especially a couple of thousand years. You know, come out of the dark ages and really emancipate themselves and have the rebirth. It's the time for transformation. And it's the time to really come to terms into what's real.
Yes.
You know? And we have to listen more to the knowledge that comes from those times, from the ancient times. life.
That there was knowledge.
That there was something. You know, we're told that this is the pinnacle of civilization.
No.
It's not.
No, we've regressed.
We've regressed.
Yes. You know, forget about our technological advances. In any way, a lot of the technology that we're seeing today is ancient technology anyway. You know, the people who govern us, you know, we're governed by 1% of the population of the world. How can that be? Do you see the state of affairs that the world is in? And we are allowing 1% of the population of the entire world to tell 99% of the entire world population what to do. I don't know about you, but I'm a free thinker.
Yes.
And 1% can't dictate to me what to do unless they hold a gun to my head. And even when they hold a gun to my head, I'm feeling like, give me liberty or give me death. Like, that's how I feel. I wouldn't have lasted 2 minutes during slavery because that's just not how I'm wired. I don't adhere well to authority at all. So, and I'm not saying that because I want to do like evil. I believe in doing the most conscious good and the least conscious evil. But I believe that we can truly govern ourselves, you know. The people who are controlling us are controlling us because they're keeping us subservient and in need while they are flourishing and they are living out every possible fantasy, every aspiration that they could possibly think of. You know, a job, not to knock anyone who has a job, but a job is just another way of being subservient, you know, especially if you work a job for the rest of your life. You should use your job to eventually financially empower you and put you in a position where you don't need a job anymore, where you can sustain yourself. But, you know, some people are comfortable where they are and they don't want the responsibility of being responsible for their own failure or success.
Yes.
And you know, I get that. I'm not one of those people, but you know, if that's you, then you know, more power to you. But for the people who want more, I suggest that you utilize you know, every opportunity, every platform that you can to take a step towards independence, you know.
Yes.
Otherwise, you're a slave.
Yes. So it is the time to stop being slaves and just emancipate yourself, free your mind.
Yeah.
So you know how in 1984, in the book by George Orwell.
Oh wow.
And also in another book, because that one, in that book, for example, by the end of it, Winston, he gave up.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem, is that there was no happy ending, but at the same time, the ending was so gruesome. It's something that we don't want to see.
Right.
It was so gloomy, because Winston gave up. He was a free thinker before, even through this really, really tough society. That's my hat. Through this really tough society. And he was one of the free people. But then, afterwards, he loved the big brother. And that's the thing, is that you can be free even in prison, as long as you're free inside, as long as you don't give up on yourself and who you are.
That's right. Once you lose yourself, and you know, lose yourself to an ideal or some kind of doctrine or whatever it is, you know, it's difficult to retain a semblance of you once you've given that to to something, to some other, to some other person's vision or cause or whatever. And you know, it's great to extend yourself and be part of, you know, something. But it's even greater to, you know, to know thyself. It says that in the book, you know, we perish for lack of knowledge of self. So knowing thyself is one of the most profound things that you'll ever find in the book.
Yes, and by the way, in the Matrix, when Neo came to the Oracle and asked if he's the one, she pointed to the sign that said, know thyself. So it meant that nobody can answer that question because he needs to find that out for himself. And he did. Afterwards, she told him what he needed to hear. So afterwards, he did find out that he was the one, but he had to feel it with his own heart and through his own choices that he had to make.
Exactly.
So know thyself is also a sign in my studio for a reason.
Okay.
Because I'm telling everyone that this is something that they need to pay attention to. And that's why on this crossroads of history is the time for people to realize their individual potential, mm-hmm. the power of the human mind.
Yes.
To realize that it is the time to also unite, but be an individual. There is a way to do this. And this ancient knowledge can really help that. And music can really help that.
Yes.
Big time. Music can truly unite people from all around the world and give them the clues and the keys. And, you know, the key to life and the keys to heaven, the keys to transition are not a physical thing, they're a spiritual thing, you know, and they are inside. And it's about the time when people have to really look within and change themselves within. Be the change you want to see.
That's right.
That's why my album is called Legends on the Map. Because we are putting legends on the map.
Okay.
We are the people.
That's right. I love it.
You know? We're here creating our own legends. We're not waiting. We're not reading just some legends from the past without being inspired to create legends now.
Absolutely.
And into the future.
It's beautiful.
Yes. Do you have any? This is New York for you. You got everything. You got a performer here.
Pero no me le una. Happy birthday.
Ready, 1, 2, 3. Hey, all right.
Dale.
Yeah, I got
okay,
it. I got
cool,
it.
Cool, cool. Got it. Yeah.
Dale.
Yeah.
Ah, no quieren.
Getting it!
No, no, no. New York City! All right. I love you.
Love you too, Papi. Mi hermano.
Okay.
Can't make that up.
Nah,
have you got any new music that people can listen to and connect to?
I am working on some new music, but it'll probably be in conjunction with my new TV show.
Woohoo!
I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag as far as what the show is going to be about and all of that, or when it's going to launch, but it's coming, I will definitely keep you posted. Jonna, she's going to be on my show.
Yeah. Amazing. Thank you. That's great. Yep. That's perfect. I mean, we are creating our own TV.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
TV shows.
Yep.
This is the time to let people know, let the world know, truly be connected.
Absolutely.
Create legends on the map. Be the TV, be the change. Speak the words.
That's right.
So I'm looking out for that, you know. I think this is showing by example.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking the words and also showing by example how it's done.
Yes.
So that's great, and I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah. So, all right. So I have the music will accompany the show. I'm writing my autobiography, and we are. I have a film production company. I'm going to take excerpts from my autobiography and commit it to the screenplay. and we're gonna make a TV series out of that as well. So two TV shows. Yeah. Huh?
Two TV shows.
Yeah.
That's it. Not one, but two.
No, two.
Maybe at some point, 10.
Exactly. Exactly.
I mean, that's great. So on that note, I would say that it's amazing talking to you. We've really have touched on some very important themes.
Yes.
Which is important for people to hear and to understand. We've touched on literally everything. The main thing is to be tuned in, connected, and it is the new time.
It is. It absolutely is. Keep your ears and eyes open.
Yes. And music will be one of the keys connecting the world.
Absolutely.
And the true knowledge. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm so happy that we had this conversation, so we shared it with people.
Yes.
Thank you.